We're so happy for the new student addition.
Yes.
She was a really impressive lady. Kind of God. Expecting good things from her. I mean, she could, we got to, the Lord got to raise up some soul. You know, in every church, you'll have a few people that really will help fill up the church. Good, some soul. But this is the purpose of this class, to stir you so that you can really begin to be mindful of your primary responsibility, which is to reach the lost. I'm going to be praying for some soul winners to be raised up in our classes. So hope you get one good one from this class. At least one. All right. Father, we thank you this evening for your grace. Your grace is sufficient. And you're able, Father, to cause all grace to abound toward us so we will have sufficiency in everything. Father, you made us able ministers of income. We can carry out your will. We can do all that you have called us to do. Father, we're asking for your grace. You have saving grace. Thank you for saving grace. We have keeping grace. Father, we thank you for keeping grace. But Father, also we have ministry grace, that you're able to lead and direct us so that we can carry your will, carry your word to the end of the earth. Father, we pray that you will make us able ministers of the new covenant, so that we will be able to reach the lost, bring them to Christ before his eternity. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we'll just go back and do Moses. You want to do a recap on Moses' prayer? Since you brought all this up. Page 143, we'll just recap Moses and we'll go back and I'll have Sister Pearl to it. Sister Pearl, could you help Sharita with the question?
Sure.
Bless her, let me call her and make arrangements to go with that. Those blessings with you. Okay, on page 143 we have the secret answers. I don't think nobody knew about these answers on the back.
Oh, yes, we did.
Yeah.
But you mentioned it to us.
I mentioned it to us.
The secret answer.
I have a page 143.
You know?
It's discipleship.
Profile. Okay, so, okay, that's what the answer is.
Okay, I have answers, but mine doesn't study.
Okay, well, we'll have to try to get. I'm not sure what I thought it was actually. Some of them stopped there when they went 37. That was the old ones.
Well, I'm going to show you how the old ones were. Mine stopped in the 107.
Ooh. Oh. Oh, you operating way better.
Okay.
Okay, we were talking about Moses, and this was a very interesting chapter because we focused more or less on Moses, a servant of the Lord, a servant of the Lord. And Moses was a very special person because when he was called to lead the children of Israel out of Egypt, I'm going to remember that Moses felt very inadequate. Felt like he wasn't able, capable of taking on that major responsibility because he was slow of speech. He could not speak as well as his brother Aaron could speak. So he felt like he was substandard. He was not up to par. And that is the thing that we're going to be sharing probably next week. When we become the righteousness of God, God gives us the ability to carry out whatever role we have with boldness and confidence. We often explain the ability of righteousness or right standing with God is a big issue. you the ability to stand before God without a sense of inferiority. That's what righteousness do, because righteousness gives you the very nature, the very ability, and strength and all of these attributes that's needed in order to fulfill your call. Those things are imparted into your life. And that's what I feel that happened to Moses. Moses was not capable, he was not adequate, or he was not sufficient in himself. But when you take on the nature of God, or the Spirit of God, anointed of God, and that comes on you, then it goes beyond your human ability or your human strength.
Okay, Pastor, just give me. Mm-hmm. When Moses was in Pharaoh's, in Egypt, mm-hmm. household, what kind of man was he then?
Okay, Brother William, you can tell us about that.
He was a prince of Egypt. He was taught by their secular scholars.
Mm-hmm. But did he feel inferior then? Did he feel?
Possibility. He did have a speech impediment, mm-hmm. but he knew who he was. Mm-hmm. He knew that he had the authority mm-hmm. to do anything that he needed to do, and that probably would help him later on in life.
Yeah, he was in charge, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He had authority because he was the second in line, the next in line for the position of king. But a lot of times people, when they're dealing with like 2.5 million people and your assignment is so difficult, you know, you got to lead these people out of Egypt, mm-hmm. despite all of the opposition you might face with leadership. That was a horrendous responsibility that he had. So naturally, most times when God even called upon us to do even minor things, we feel what, inadequate. Ask somebody to get up and give a testimony. He said, "Oh, no, I can't do that. Oh, you can just stand up over everybody and talk." So we feel that way. But when Christ comes in, there comes a boldness. I remember that I was very shy, and I wouldn't get up before anybody to say anything. Very, very bashful. I feel so beat down, like inferior, because of some of the things that happened in my childhood. Beyond my control, I just felt like I was the black sheep of the family. And but when I got saved, although I did good in school, I was the valedictorian of my class in high school, but yet I still felt bad about myself. I just felt like I was not capable of really being, you know, successful. And I just felt inferior to almost everybody. But when I got saved and filled with the Holy Spirit, then a boldness came over me. And I guess the first thing that I said when I got filled with the Holy Ghost, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Greater is he that is in me. If any man be in Christ, that's what I began to say. And this is the way God has designed for all of us to feel adequate, to feel worthy, to feel capable, or to get beyond all of the feelings of inferiority after we're saved. We have to begin to acknowledge, we have to begin to confess all of these strengths and abilities that God has just released into our lives. He does release all of these abilities in our lives when we get saved. But most times people don't believe it, they don't feel it, they never confess it. And many times people never know that of his fullness we have already received. We are complete in him. So I feel that the message that we got to get over soon is that God is the one that makes us able. But there's a godless side and there's a manless side. God has already broke the power of sin and the dominion of spiritual death, the power of the devil. He has already broke that power of all our lives. But the part that we have to assume, the responsibility that we have to assume, is we got to agree with God. Okay, for instance, I'm I'm delivered from the power of darkness. That's what the Bible says about us when we get saved or born again. The power of sin on our life is what completely broken. That's exactly what happened. If any man be in Christ, he becomes what? A new creature. Your spirit is what? A new creature. Your man is got to be renewed, but your man will catch up after a while, right? And you'll overcome the feelings that you still feel like you're still the same old, same old. But you'll get over that as you begin to confess the word. Now, this is one thing that I wanted to do today, but I couldn't get to it. That you will never really realize and experience the fullness of God and the completeness and the perfection that God has placed or released into us until you begin to acknowledge it. You got to begin to agree with God. God says that I'm delivered from the power of darkness. I'm a new creature in Him. I'm complete in Him. I can do all things through Him that strengthens me. I have to open my mouth. And here is the point that we fail. And we never get over that. I can, I'm able, I'm not able, I'm not worthy, I ain't good enough. We never get beyond that because we never really focus on acknowledging or confessing the things that God has made us or the thing that God has what? Done in our lives. When you begin to confess that I'm complete in Him, at some point you're going to what? You're going to begin to step out and you're going to feel that what? You got what it takes in the Lord, amen, to what? Overcome whatever you're dealing with. You're going to feel it. You're going to experience it. It's going to become a part of it. You're going to begin to get very bold. The Bible says the righteous is as bold as a what? Lion. But the wicked will flee when nobody is what? Fleeing. Nobody's chasing. All right, so I got to get that over because if we don't ever get it over, we'll never feel like we're capable enough to do anything. Sometimes we won't talk to people because I might mess up. I might say the wrong thing. I don't know enough. Okay, so that's what Moses overcame. And as you began to confess who you are and say about yourself what the Bible or the Word says about you, then you begin to eliminate a lot of that what feeling of what insecurity or inferiority. Or you sometimes people feel like they are unworthy. That's the way I felt. I felt like I was the black sheep. I felt like everybody was better than I am because I had this impediment in my speech. And I had some bad teeth that grew under, that grew wrong at the top. And I wasn't about to open my mouth to talk to nobody because my teeth at the top had grown behind each other. And it looked really bad. And for many years, I was injured and I felt inferior. And that caused really an emotional problem. So I finally, in my 11th grade year in high school, I was able to get it get a bridge. I had those bad, ugly teeth pulled, and I got a bridge. And I was cute then. But the damage had already been done. I still felt the handicap. I didn't get over that until I made Jesus my Lord. I began to practice saying things that enable me to get over that. The scriptures that I constantly repeat, those were the scriptures I was birthed on. Greater is He that is in me. When you feel like a champ, you feel something, it makes you feel on top when you confess things that God has already done for you. And that will kick in if you keep saying it. You have to keep on saying it, and one day you will be amazed as to the very thing that you've been saying has become reality. That's how faith works. And this is the way that we will get beyond. Today I was speaking about holiness, how you can live a life that will be pleasing to God. You don't have to give in to sin and be victimized by what? Your flesh. And go through all of the changes that the devil tries to put you through by messing up consistently. You build your life up by confession. The Bible says that when you confess who you are, then what happens, eventually, what you confess, you become. Whatever you keep on saying, that will become reality. You frame your world that you live in by the words that you say. And you can hang yourself, amen, with your tongue. A lot of people are hung by the tongue. Mm-hmm. Right? You want to sink your ship, amen, just lose control of your lips and start saying things contrary to the word of God. You always want to say, and this is the way it's supposed to be. Many times people don't understand how our walk with the Lord is supposed to be. When we first get saved, the only way you can get saved, you have to what? Confess the Lordship of Jesus. You have to confess with your mouth that Jesus, what, died on the cross, he was buried, and he rose again. And you got to what? Believe it in your heart. Right? You got to say it with your mouth and what? Believe it with your heart. Now, that's the thing that gets you into the door of salvation. But in order to enjoy all of these rights and privileges, man, we got a ton of the thing that enables you to enjoy all of the rights and privileges as born-again believers is that you got to what? You got to claim them. You got to confess them. You got to affirm them. If you don't affirm them, they'll never become real. And this is the biggest mistake that I've seen today in the church. You very rarely hear anybody saying what they are in Christ. I guess we're scared. God says that he's redeemed me from the curse of the law. He's supposed to what? He's supposed to say.
Or either we're not taught properly.
Huh?
Or either we're not taught properly.
Yeah, right. Yeah, many times we're not taught to do that. And if we don't do that, that means that it's going to, although the same filled with the Holy Spirit, you're still going to be living beneath your privilege. I mean, the blessings will just what pass right over you because you are not making those things that the Lord said you are reality in your life. And the only way you can make any of the word reality in your life, you have to what? Find that word, and you have to begin to what? Speak that word back to God. That's the reason why some of y'all probably have noticed, I hope you have, that in my prayer, I try to always pray the word or agree with the word. The word says it, I'm going to say it. Jesus said the same thing. He said, I am the resurrection and I'm the life. He always mentioned who he was. I am, me and my Father are one. Things that I do are not mine, but it's the Father that doeth. I cast out devils by the Spirit of God. He always confessed who he was, what his abilities that God had given him were. And as a result of that, everything that he confessed and prayed or whatever he said always came to pass. Now, if I could get everybody to do that, I could change everybody's life even almost in a short period of time. We even have a little book that have all of these things you need to be saying in them. And it tells about your sons of God. The scripture that tells about I'm a son of God. The Bible says that we're heirs of God and we are what? Joint heirs. Things like that we need to really be saying. I'm a new creature, created in righteousness and true holiness. That makes you feel good. I mean, if you say that enough, do you believe that will put a different mindset into your life?
Yes, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But many times we're quick to confess what we're not. Oh, I can't do that. Oh, I'm so broke, I'll never be able to. Oh, I'm not able to do that. I don't have the money. I mean, we're always quick to say how bad we are, that's right, how weak we are, and how oh, we missed it and all of that, but we never agree with God when he gives us all of his promises concerning what he has made us, and we fail to what? To agree with him or to affirm. So I believe Moses got out of that rut. Because he never would have made that great leader if he had stayed in that rut. So he finally came to the point that he began to feel like he was capable of carrying out that commission. And the reason why, because he began to agree with God, and also because he began to work with God. How many know that we are workers together with him? And when you stay in God's presence long enough and work with him and become co-laborers together with him, then things began to what? Change. You began to see yourself in a different what? Light. Amen. Now, remember the illustration of Abraham? Abraham had been promised a son, and for how many years it hadn't come to pass? I believe at 75, he was making that promise. And for about 25 years, that promise had come to pass. He was doing everything he could to make it come to pass. He was having sex with
Hagar.
I mean, in those days it was okay if you had maids and you what? You had sex with them. Well, thank God we passed that.
That's right.
You have your best of day with it. Okay, but God had to do something specific in Moses' life in order to get that promise to pass. He changed his name from what? Abram to Abraham. Abram, I don't know what Abram meant, but Abraham meant what? Father of many nations. And Abraham, rather than saying, I'm Abram, he began to say, I'm the father of many nations. Because God had promised him a what? Son. And he said, if God said it, what? So shall it be. So I'm just going to what? Praise God, give him praise, and count it what? Done. And count those things that be not as what? Though they are. And what he kept saying, and every time people met him, he says that, hello, father of many nations. He called himself, every time he introduced himself, I'm the father of many nations. Because God told him that he would be what? The father. So he began to what? Confess it. And he changed Sarai's name from Sarai to what? Sarah, the mother of many. All right, so she began to open her mouth and say, I'm the mother of many, before she was the mother of any. She didn't have no kids, couldn't have none. Too old, almost 100 years old. And she began to say, I'm the mother of many. I'm the mother of many. I'm the mother of many. See, God's word in your mouth is very, very powerful. If you say what God says, you're going to be a mighty person. That's how you get over sin and beyond sin and get to the point where you don't want to do sin no more. You begin to say what? Sin shall not have dominion. Say that enough. Amen. Say things like, it says, let not sin reign in your mortal body, but yield ye your members as instruments of righteousness unto God, and not instruments of sin to Satan. When you begin to say things that shows you that you are the mastery of evil, mastery of the flesh, mastery of Satan, mastery over the world, then what's going to happen is that God is going to make you, he's going to elevate you to that position where all of that will become reality. Because the word of God, I mean, the words coming out of your mouth controls, y'all believe this, it controls everything. Your money, your relationship, your ability to win people, it controls everything. Amen. Just say it in a word, and it will become reality if it's in line with what? God's word. How many can say amen?
Amen.
So Moses became a great man because that transformation took place in his life. And after he saw all of those miracles, and he saw that he could just speak words, and what things would happen. And all those miracles that what just began to pop up. And Moses began to feel like he was about something. So God, what? He stood behind his word. And here's what God said. Let me see how many of y'all know what this means. God said, I create the fruit of your lips. What does that mean? I create the fruit of your lips. What does that mean?
Let's see. The world was built upon the word. So therefore, you have, when you speak, you act and you manifest, you got the power of God because he spoke the world into existence.
Right, that's right. And whatever you say that's consistent with God's word, yes. He's going to what? He's going to make it happen. He's going to create. Is that good news or not?
Yes.
Somebody said, I'm scared. It might not happen. Might not turn out like I say. All right. That's up to you. All right. So Moses completely surrendered to the will of God. And one thing that we saw that he did, he forsook all his worldly ambitions to answer the call of God. Amen. That was a great move that Moses made in order to answer the call of God. He was the second in line for the position of king, and he said that he felt like the call of God was more important than for him to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. So he was willing to suffer 40 years almost, 40 years with the people of God going through all types of things. How many remember the wilderness experience for 40 years? Those people went through a whole lot. Many of them got judged and perished and all kind of plagues and things. They were smitten because they were so rebellious and stubborn and stiff-necked and full of what?
Always complaining.
Always complaining. And Moses had to put up with that junk for 40 years. And the last year, he lost his cool. And he did something that God told him not to do. And he didn't get a chance to experience that land that he had waited 40 years to go into and enjoy the fruit of that land and that hard journey experience. All right, so those that haven't worked this message out, it would be good for you to work it out, but we're just kind of touching on it. The high points, his willingness to suffer affliction for the people of God in order to deliver Israel from bondage. So Moses went through 40 years of suffering just to answer the call of God and to be in a position where he could carry out God's will. And Moses emerged as a very important person. I'm going to turn to that page. The theme of page 22, 23. On page 23, we say, let me see where I want to start at. Let's put it over here. The burden and hardship from the 2.5 million Israelites plus was quite severe and grievous. At times he became extremely faint-hearted, despaired of life. He fell many times on his face, crying out to God for help and strength to endure. On one occasion, during his most difficult and darkest hour, he appealed to God to take his life because of the burden he was carrying. So he must have been under a lot of pressure. Anybody pray to God to take their life must be under a whole lot of burden. How many heard the story of somebody came to Brother Kenneth Hagin and said, Brother Hagin, pray that I will never again have any more problems. Pray that I will never, how many will I to not have any more problems? Well, Brother Hagin said, the only way I can pray, I have to pray that God take you. God take you home. If God took you, then you wouldn't have. But you might have some problems if you're not ready to go, huh? All right. Moses was with the Lord for prolonged and difficult periods on Mount Sinai, receiving the law and statutes for Israel. He spent at least two 40-day periods along with the Lord, both 40-day periods, you might have aid for a trip. Amen. How many of you believe that you can hold out 40 days? You know, in order to be that perfect vessel, would you be willing to do it? In order to be used like Moses, would you be willing to do it? Well, I can't do without my son too that long. All right. Okay. Moses complained to God 11 times. He was rebuked and chastised by God. And by one act of disobedience, he was not permitted to enter into the promised land. This act of irreverence for God and disrespect to the people of Israel was very costly and prevented Moses from receiving his cherished dream. I think the thing that he said, he called them rebels. Disrespected, you call them out of their name. Like somebody, I guess today, calling somebody a bad name. And God didn't like it because, you know, he was dishonoring his people. And God said, well, for all of this rebellion, amen. See, like two acts of disobedience. Amen.
Could it be because when they left Egypt that there were Egyptians amongst them, and there were Ethiopians also?
Yeah, it was a mixed bubble group.
So they kind of stirred the pot up a little bit?
Yeah.
Because they were of a different mindset?
Right. But it could be, and then, you know, people have a lot of mess in them anyway, whether they get it from somebody else or not. But the mixed multitude did play a major role. And another thing, too, is that when Aaron made the golden calf, when Moses came down from the mountain with the Ten Commandments, Moses saw them worshiping that golden calf. I don't think all of it was due to the mixed multitude. I think a lot of it was just rebellion, for rebellion's sake, because they were environments, whenever they went into environments where people worship idols, they always what? Eventually started what? Getting into idolatrous worship. So I don't think the mixed multitude had a whole lot to do with it, but it had some. But they were just rebellious people that Bible says was hard, were not set right, they didn't believe God. And it was a lot of unbelief. They just didn't have the faith like Caleb and who?
Joshua.
They were the only two out of that 2.5 million that completely followed the Lord. The Bible says only followed. It might have been that they were very closely connected to Moses. And they were kind of like at Moses' side. And they experienced all of these different signs and wonders and miracles of the supernatural. And when Moses was up on the mountain for 40 days, they were, accompanying him. I know Joshua was. So I believe that contact and that fellowship or relationship Moses was largely the reason why Joshua and Caleb were capable of entering into the promised land. But all of these things, on page 23, he became Israel's deliverer, lawgiver, ruler, and greatest prophet. He was called the servant of the Lord. And every time you read about Moses carrying out the will of God, the Bible says that he did it just as God had what? Commanded him to do it. You know, that man was just so precise. You know, all of these rules that the priests had to follow, they had to remember about 500 or 600 different types of different things to do in the course of their operation, their ministry. And Moses had to give them all that came from God, like all of those instructions as to how they carry out their priestly ministry, how to build the tabernacle, the colors, and how, you know, the different types of material cloth,
the robes,
and man, it was just thousands of instructions. That man seemed like a genius to me. And God was able to communicate all of that through him, and the Bible says he carried it out exactly as God had commanded him. Sometimes we get it 10% right, 50% right, we think we do what? Good. All right, but that's the thing that stands out in Moses' life that really challenges me. Whatever God told him to do, he what? He carried it out to the T. Amen. That's a good lesson for all of us, especially if we want to perfect holiness in the fear of God. All right, now we can all of that. He had a whole lot of accolades attached to his name. You can read that again, but if you haven't been over this, somebody will go over it with you. But he was a very outstanding man, and I don't want to get too far involved in that because it's going to be repetitious for some of us. Okay, now we'll be just looking at Moses. Let's go to lesson 4. All right, so those that have not done lesson 1, 2, and 3, Sister Pearl will help you, and she'll go over with them. She'll take time. She'll be very patient. And she'll do question by question, answer by answer. All right, this is my favorite lesson on page 27? Is it 27? Okay. All right, following the example of Jesus. Okay. All right, Ephesians 5:1, be ye therefore followers of God as what? Dear children. All right, we're to be followers of God as what? Dear children. He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also to what? Walk, even as he walked. 1 Peter 2:21, let's read that together. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, that we should follow. Okay. The objective of this lesson is to get a full revelation of God's plan for us by looking at the example of Jesus. To understand the meaning of discipleship and what it means to follow Jesus. 3, to see how our commitment to prayer is directly linked to the results we experience in life and in the ministry. Our commitment to prayer. Okay, the example of Jesus that we are to follow in order to know the ways of God. Jesus, the Son of God, came to reveal to us the Father and to make plain to us the will of God. Christ's decision to wholly submit to the will of God. All right, how many remember how Christ existed before he became a man? How many know how Christ used to exist? Well, today he's back at the right hand of God. But how did he exist before he became Jesus? Was he an angel? Was he a spirit? All right. He was actually a spirit being. He was the second person of the what?
Godhead.
And he was the Son of God. And he had the same powers and the same prerogatives and privileges and glory and anointing or whatever. He was equal with God. Is that right?
Yes.
Co-equal with God. Okay. All right. His pre-existent commitment to give his life for the world. All right. Somebody explain that to me. His pre-existent commitment to give his life for the world.
Is said before the foundation of the world that he agreed to place himself upon, to place himself as an offering for the sins of man.
Okay. All right. This was an agreement that they made in the Godhead before they created the earth, before they created man, before anybody ever existed here on this earth. How could they make those kind of arrangements when nothing was here and nobody was even created?
But they were not knowing, so they knew what would happen.
Okay.
They knew they were going to make earth.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
They knew they were going to make man here.
Mm-hmm.
And they knew that Satan would fall, Adam would fall under the sway of Satan.
Mm-hmm.
And they knew that, they knew what they would tell.
Mm-hmm.
What they would tell Adam.
Mm-hmm.
But they knew that they told that to Adam. And Adam told it to Eve, mm-hmm. not to eat of the tree.
Mm-hmm.
They did not tell that to Satan. And so I believe that Satan kept coming in the garden. He kept coming in the garden and eating of the trees. And they saw that he did not fall dead. And so, he kept coming. He kept coming. And so, but they were supposed to do what God told them to do. Instead, they did what Satan told them to do. And that was sin.
Okay. So, God and Jesus, well, he wasn't Jesus then, he was Christ. All right, Christ existed before Jesus did? Y'all get me right now. Did Christ exist before Jesus did?
Yes.
Yes. Hang on. Give me that look.
Okay.
Did Christ exist before Jesus did?
Well, that name, he was Christ before he came to the earth.
Okay, Christ was when Jesus was not. Everybody agree with that? Christ was when Jesus was not.
Right.
But Jesus was not when Christ was not. Oh, I confused you.
He wasn't in his mortal body. That's what you're saying.
Oh, okay. Christ was when Jesus was not, but Jesus was not when Christ was not.
Right.
Anybody can figure that out?
That
sounds like one of
them. I'm sure.
Stop some riddles.
Okay. Christ was not in his physical form at that particular time. He wasn't in his mortal temple.
Right.
In other words.
Right, okay. Okay, but when Jesus came, Jesus was not when Christ was not.
Yeah, because he had to put aside his divinity.
Right, okay. So what we're saying here, for all of you that don't get the riddle, is that when Christ in his pre-existence state, in other words, before he became a man, see, we have to look at Christ as being a deity part of God, the God part of the Godhead, the God part. And Jesus is the what? Humanity. See, Jesus was both God and what? Man. Everybody understand that? He was, Jesus Christ meant that he was what? He was all man and he was all what? God. Right? All God, because the Christ meant the God part of him. That refers to his deity, Christ. He was deity, he was Christ before he became what? A human being.
Right.
Because he existed as what? God. Right? And he had the same prerogatives, the same privileges, and they were co-equal, including the Holy Spirit, all of them were co-equal in what? Power.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody understand that? Okay, now, when he became man, it had to be a special operation of the Holy Spirit that would cause this virgin, what was her name?
Mary,
to be what? Impregnated by a seed. Now, how can a woman get pregnant without a human seed being placed in her? Okay, who put that seed in her womb?
The Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit. Y'all believe the Holy Spirit got that much power?
Yes.
Okay. So when Mary conceived Jesus by the Holy Spirit, then that was the what? The human side of what? God. Because God is the one that put the seed into what? Mary. So God became man, and his name was called what?
Jesus,
right? He was God in the what? Flesh. He was God in the flesh. Okay, now, the part that Jesus relinquished, you know, this was a decision that they made. Let's say they sat down. They sat down at the conference table. Mm-hmm. Let's say a million years before man ever came to the scene, and they said, "Well, all three of us know the end from the beginning. We know exactly what we're going to do in the future, although it might be 10 million years ahead. We're going to what? End up making a home for a man, God and." Christ, they said that we're very lonely and we want some children. We want somebody to fellowship with, and we want to raise we want to have a family, a human family on the earth. So let's go to work and let's plan a home for man, and let's make sure that everything that my love child, that special child that he would create, make sure that every need that he will ever dream of would be included in this what? Creation of this world, this universe that we're going to make. So that's the reason why the earth is full of all of the nice fruits and vegetables and flowers and rivers and plateaus and oceans and all of this God created for who? Man. So his life could be what? Full, complete. And he would have at his fingertips everything that his heart would ever desire. They planned that out even before they even created a man. But they also saw man coming into the picture, and that man would be created, and out of that creation he would get from the man's what? Side, a rib, and form a what? Woman. But they will have some problems. They would have some problems. So he knew that they would what? They would succumb to one of Satan's what? Tricks. And be deceived. And God said, Well, this is going to happen. And when man falls, and when he sinned, and when he becomes victimized by the devil, we're going to have a plan in place to redeem him or to put him back into what? Fellowship with God. So the plan of redemption was formulated even before man was ever made. So God had the answer before the problem. Right? He had made provisions for man's restitution before he ever what? Ever needed it. Because God is all what? Wise and all knowing. And he made all of those arrangements and plans for our salvation even before we were brought here. Isn't that good? Okay. Now, what did Jesus have to do to make all of that reality? He had to find a way, because he knew that when man sinned and failed, that the redemption would require a man, what? Redeeming the fallen man. An angel couldn't do it. Any old man, no sacrifice would work. It would have to be a what? God-man. And it would have to be somebody more powerful than Satan, who caused him to what? Fall. So whoever this man was, he had to be what? Stronger than Satan, And he would have to what? Defeat Satan and take the dominion, because when man sinned, although God had placed the entire control of the universe into whose hands?
Adam.
But when he sinned, he what? Blew it, lost control. And who took the control over?
Satan.
And who still got the control?
Satan.
Over the world, okay.
Okay,
but amen. He's the God of this world. The small
G.
Old G of this world. The only way we get the mastery over him is that we have to be in Christ. And that came through what? Redemption. So we can take back everything that what? Satan stole. But it's all through Christ. And that's what the Battle of the Ages was all about. Okay, so in order for him to come down in the form of a man, he had to relinquish every right and privilege that made him God. He had to what? He had to lay it aside. Because he had to strip himself of all of the things that made him what? God. That meant that not his holiness, he didn't have to strip himself of that, because those are attributes you don't strip yourself of. But things like he was all wise. Amen. He knew the end from the beginning, so he had to come down in the form of a what? Man. So when he came to this earth, when he was born, did he have to grow in grace?
Yes.
Did he have to grow in wisdom?
Yes.
Did he have to grow in stature?
Yes.
Did he have to grow in favor with God and man? So he had to relinquish all of those attributes and come down in the form, the same form that we exist in, with the same limitations that we have, in order to redeem us. Because if he didn't do that, then we would have an excuse like this. Okay, what excuse would we have? Now, Jesus was God. I can't be like him. I can't live without sin. I can't have victory over the devil. I can't do the works of Jesus. Man, I'm just a man. Now Jesus, he did it so every excuse that we would have to say that I can't do it, I'm not able, I'm not capable, I'm not worthy or whatever, he has eliminated all of those excuses, because he came down and started all over again, and he did it just like all of us have to what? Do it today. We have to grow, we have to what? Get mature, we have to be exposed to who? The devil. Y'all believe that Jesus was tempted just like we were?
Yes.
He had to go through every experience that we as human beings have to go through, so that we could see him laying aside this what? This God side of him. You understand what I'm saying? He didn't do anything when he came down on this earth as God. And that's the sacrifice he made. He was willing to what? To come down down on earth and operate and work and do whatever he was supposed to do in those 33 years as a man, anointed by the Holy Ghost, and not as what? God, who was with the Father from the beginning. He did it as a what? Man. He was all powerful. Did he exert all power when he came down here? No. Okay, if I had a coat on, I could demonstrate it. If I had a coat on, I would just pull my coat off. This coat represents those powers that he had as God. Omnipotent, omniscient, all wisdom, all knowing, all powerful. He had all of these, his glory, mighty power and glory, and the ability to just say things, and as God, and things would take place. But he laid aside, he pulled his coat off, those were those outward powers. And he came down in the form of a what? Of a servant. So all of the miracles he did it as God. Is that right? Right, he did it as a man. All right, all of the things that we do it as a what? As a man, a woman, anointed by God. So that's the reason why he had to do it. He had to do it that way. Now, another thing that you might realize that too, he had to come directly in contact in terms of with temptations with the devil. The first Adam came into contact with the devil in terms of temptation. And the first Adam, what? Blew it. He yielded, right? The second Adam, in order to be our Redeemer, he couldn't what? He couldn't blow it. If he had blown it, if he had yielded, he wouldn't have qualified as our Redeemer. The only person that can defeat Satan would have to be a person that's what? Greater than Satan. If Jesus had sinned, he would not have been what? Greater than Satan. Because he didn't sin, he faced Satan in many, many, many combats. I mean, the devil tried to get him to what? Jump off the building. Tried to get him to turn stones into what? Bread. And he promised him what? Took him up on the mountain and showed him all of the what?
Kingdoms of the world.
Kingdoms of the world in a moment's time. And he said, if you just kneel down and worship me, I'll give you the power over all of these kingdoms. Did he really have power over those kingdoms?
Yes.
He actually did, because he was what? Operating with the dominion, the lost dominion, complete control of the universe. That's what the first man had before he what? Sinned. And handed over to what? Slewfoot. But Jesus, being who he was, and he stood up under all of those temptations, and he actually became the only person in the universe that were capable of what? Taking man's place or becoming man's substitute. In order for him to take man's place and to redeem him back to God, he would have to die on a cross. All right, he would have to die, because the wages of sin is what? Death. The sin that humanity was guilty of demanded what? Death. The only way that debt could be settled was that somebody had to die. And the only person capable of dying for the sins of the whole world was what? One man. And who was that? Can't we appreciate him a lot more now?
Yes.
He was the only person. Amen. Praise God. When we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. Scarcely for a righteous man will one dare to die. But he committed his love toward us while we were yet sinners. Now, the beauty part of it is that when Jesus died, his spirit came out of his body. And Satan is a spirit being, right? And he had to defeat Satan and take the dominion away from him. The only way he could take that dominion from him, he would have to meet Satan in combat in spirit form. How many know Jesus' body was in what? The tomb. Is that right? But his spirit was what? Went down to hell, right? And wherever that battle took place, I don't know whether it took place in hell, whether it took place in the second heavens, where Satan's kingdom is what? Is lunch. I mean, somebody says Satan lives in hell, but he's not really in hell. Mm-hmm. He's in what? The second heaven. Amen. He's up in there somewhere. Y'all looking up? All right. So, but when Jesus died and came out in open combat against the devil, he defeated him through the help of what? God and the, what, and the Holy Spirit. Everybody came to Jesus as what? Rescue. And he was able to defeat who? Satan. And he stripped him of his what? Authority. And he left him trembling, defeated, bloody. We just said, bleeding in his own boots. He defeated him and stripped him of all of his power. And he grabbed that dominion. He grabbed it from him. And we all know the rest is history. The third day he came back into his body after he had gotten dominion over the devil, whipped him, and defeated him and took the dominion from him. Then he got back into his body, and it was a glorified body then. And he rose again the third day. And when he arose, he was waving that symbol of authority. I am he that was dead. But now I'm alive, and I'm alive forevermore. Behold, I have power over all power of the enemy. All power in heaven and in earth. That means authority. He had gotten that authority that Satan had run with all of those years. He had what? He had gotten it back. Amen. Praise God. That he was ruling. He said, behold, I give you authority. That dominion has been given to what? Every believer. That's the same dominion that we started out with in Africa. We have dominion over what? Over the earth. How many believe? How many people will you get to believe that? Nobody. I pull on me. I'm barely struggling. Man, I can't even pay more. I can't even buy gas to get home. How about dominion? That means our mind's got to be what? That's the job. Because of joy, we can't get people to say that. They can say, I'm broke. They'll say that quick. I'm broke. But they won't say that the blessings of the Lord makes me rich. They have no sorrow. They won't say that. They're scared to say stuff like that. They feel like it'd be lying. And all they're saying is what? What? God said, right? All right. I'm going to let y'all go. Amen. But that's kind of like the story of our redemption, which I really, really, really like. So I just want you to go over and look at all of the scriptures that I've touched on. And I think that you will be able to answer the questions on page 33 after you have read all of the material. Then you can write down the answers. Amen. The most important part of this lesson is that this lesson is trying to show you that if Jesus did everything that he did as a man, then that same ability that enabled him to do it, he did everything as what? As a man, what? Anointed by what?
God.
The Holy Ghost, anointed by God. Amen. When do we get anointed? When do we get saved? When we what? Receive Jesus, right? Now, what do we get when we get, when we receive Jesus? Do we get the power, or do we get the authority when we first get saved? See, Jesus said, all power in heaven and in earth has been given to me. Jesus spoke about authority, then he spoke about power. When do we get power? Of the ability to become the sons of God. When do we get that?
When we first get saved.
When we first get saved. Everybody is given what? Dominion. Everybody said dominion.
Dominion.
That's the same dominion that who had initially?
Adam.
All right, the Bible says all things belongs to what? You. You become an heir of God, and you become a joint heir. I mean, it's not, everything that God wants to do is not perfected there. It's kind of like a baby when he's born, although he's not mature, but yet he's perfect. Is he a perfect baby? Are all of the ingredients and components in his body that will make him a perfect being?
Yeah.
At birth? Somebody said, well, I don't see his teeth. He ain't getting no teeth. But those teeth are what? They're aligned or man. At the proper time, under the proper what? Care and nourishment, those things will be what? Perfectly what? Developed. And that's how we are when we first get saved. We are complete. How many can say complete?
Complete.
Ain't nothing missing about you. Oh, I wish I could get people to believe. Sister. But like, what can I do to get people to believe that? You'll never see it until you what? Acknowledge it. You got to say what? I'm complete. Greater is he that is what? In me. That's the biggest problem we have in the church today. Nobody, I guess everybody is scared to confess or to agree with what God says about it. Everybody's scared, I guess. Y'all think it's, they scared, or do you believe that they just don't? It just hasn't gotten through their psyche. What do y'all, how do y'all feel about that? Because the Bible says, name all these things, whatever you face and confront, whatever you go through, you're more than a conqueror. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. That salvation, when you got saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, that's the victory that overcomes everything. You become an heir of God. The Bible says we reign. That means we rule, we control. Do y'all believe that most people don't understand it? They don't believe it? Or they haven't read it? Or they think that you'd be lying if you said all of this stuff? I want to get y'all impression before I turn y'all loose.
Step higher until God give me some more scriptures.
Well, let me tell you, prayer can be so exciting. Y'all don't know what you're missing. Amen. But I want y'all to pray about this because we're going to start talking probably next Sunday on the importance of confession, our agreeing with God. We got to get something coming out of our what? Now. Now, some of y'all come to prayer, y'all just sit and read and look and stare. I guess I'll just do this. When you should have what? Something coming out of your mouth that agree with God. Because all of those rights and privileges are all you and amen. God wants to bring them forth, but he can't. His hands are tied if nothing is coming out of your mouth. If nothing is coming out of your mouth, his hands are tied. That's the biggest mistake that will keep you broke forever. You will never. If you want to get out of whatever you're in, start saying what God says about your finances, about your successes or your things you're facing, your challenges. Start saying what God says. That's the thing that will turn your life around. And that's the quickest way to get your faith activated. It's the quickest way. That's the reason why the Bible says, hold fast to your confession of faith without wavering, because he is what? Faithful that promise. He said, don't cast away your confidence because it has great recompense of reward. But it requires patience after you what? Agree with God, after you what? Confess things. It's not going to just evolve overnight. It's going to take a while, but God promised to create the fruit of your lips. Amen. So I'm going to try to get this, drill this through y'all head some kind of way in the next month or two of confessional. Might be a drill. A spiritual dream. Come up with something, Joy. Come up with something. All right, that's all. All right, now here's a book that I'm going to recommend. If you want, I'll talk about this later. New Creation Realities. Everything that God has made you. It's a little book. Some of you already have it. It's Thanksgiving. It's a little yellow book. But this book tells about all of the things that God has made you in terms of redemptive realities. And I will explain it later on. Don't worry about it right now. Expanding your faith capability through Thanksgiving. That's a real good little book because it deals with all of the things and realities that God has what? Dumped in our laps. And he's just waiting for us to find them and begin to what? Speak them back to him. Okay, now y'all got something to work with. Now how many got the great book?
Yes.
The great prayer confession book.
Yes.
That's the same thing, basically. Amen. So do that. But we want to hear you in prayer. Say something. So I'm going to start coming around y'all prayers. Are they saying anything at all? Are they giving God anything at all? Alright, let's stay. Let y'all go. I want God to raise y'all up because we gotta carry out our commission and do what God says when we come. And the only way we can do it is that we have to what? Flow in the Spirit and realize ourselves on that thing. Father, we thank you for leading and directing all that we said and do. We give you praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Now next week, I will ask Sister Pinola.